status to all the position.
Sorry about the time to get here. I left my phone in the prep room and only realized after I got here.
Are y'all in physics and math too? Are y'all in physics and math?
Yes.
Oh, that's a lot. I mean, I say this if we were at like California last year, we didn't walk too much.
I don't know anything about that.
Alright, I'm good to go.
Sure.
Alright.
I don't know. Are you?
No.
Oh.
That's what you're saying. Alright. Start with plan. UN should substantially increase funding of water filtration and production to developing nation states by providing $400 million US dollars in water sprint technology to eligible countries. The United Nations should substantially increase funding of water filtration and production to developing nation states by providing $400 million US dollars in water sprint technology to eligible countries. Background, or framework. The first part of this amendment is the A point, but this is the key to education world where we have a more objective calculus of time frame probability magnitude. We can better evaluate what is better for our education in the real world. The argument is this is also key to praxis because we can evaluate the critical impacts as well as policy impacts of tools. We can actually create something effectual change rather than just sitting around smoking weed and hitting drum circle. We see arguments. This is also key to stopping judge intervention because they don't have to insert their personal subjective experiences in the ground, so it's more fair for the debaters as well as the judges. The argument is this is also key to critical ground because the benefits allows for both arguments to be argued against each other, but this also is key to reducing dogmatism because you can actually criticize yourself rather than just talk about how policy is better. The first argument is that the UNICEF website on March 17th says that the UN provides about $892 million US dollars in water filtration and sanitation efforts, and they rely on two specific categories, clean drinking water and infrastructure, specifically things like wells in developing countries. The little aid under this is that moving water is incredibly heavy and hard. It's hard to transport. It's about 8.3 pounds per gallon, which makes it incredibly hard for them to be able to just give water to them, give water filtration. The two arguments, the infrastructure gets torn, the infrastructure that they do give to developing nations often gets completely torn up because of the fact that it's given to war-torn areas, which means that it's completely insolvent. The third argument is that the UN is not, it does not have a ton of credibility on the issue of water conflicts in intervening right now because of their interactions with developing countries. Being reactive, but not proactive, right, when it comes to water. Salt. The first argument is that water filtration is a key to potable water for millions of individuals, as well as a reduction of disease spread. The two arguments is that water spray technology is really great. The implement of this is that it's incredibly portable because it weighs only a couple pounds, as well as the fact it only needs one little unit in order to produce about 1,000 liters per day, and it has a solar panel, so it makes it sustainable in the long term. The third argument is that we don't send people with a plan, we just send the technology. All they have to do is essentially turn it on. The fourth argument is it's also great because it's cheap and it's easy to replace, as well as the fact that it's durable and low upkeep, which means that it's perfect for developing nations to benefit from. The first argument is that more superbugs are evolving the status quo due to the evolution rate, specifically in water. The A point is that around 700 million people in 43 developing countries suffer water scarcity in the status quo. The B argument is that most don't have access to clean drinking water in particular because it's either dirty or just doesn't exist in the area in an accessible format. The C argument is that people oftentimes share water with like livestock as well as non-human animals in the area, which increases the risk of transferal of genes like diseases as well as genes between bacteria and viruses. And specifically, the examples of isolate are things like the H1N1 as well as the avian flu. Both came from animal to human transference. The D argument is that water scarcity is only going to increase in the status quo without filtration because it is hard to get there. Because often the places that the superbugs evolve are hard to get to or hard to get out of, right? But easy to get to with cars, which means disease spreads, but water is not easy to get. The links. The first argument is that the plan passes so millions get filtered and gets filtered water. The A point of this is that the UN wants to work with water spreads the status quo and use their technology.
They just want that.
The PR is that the water sprint technology is also great because it's 98% more energy efficient than other infrastructure that the UN could build. Yeah. The two arguments, this also spotlights the issue of water infrastructure, which is incredibly important because it boosts human credibility as well. It's the fact that it allows for water to become reactive, proactive approaches to water filtration and water distribution to be spotlighted. The Third argument is that this spills over to other states as well. Even if they're not providing the technology by the UN like endorsing it, makes it more viable, the internal links. The first argument is that the probability of a superbug is increasing in status quo. We say that we've already seen antibiotic-resistant bacteria and some that are resistant to all forms of antibiotics, even the last resort. The two argument is that our antibiotics are not going to be able to keep up, even if we reduce the rate of resistant bacteria. Now, we cannot keep up with the transferal rate of genes, as well as the fact that we can't deal with viruses because antibiotics just don't work on viruses. Science. The third argument is that the WHO, in particular, indicates that it's a question of when, not if, superbugs will eventually lead to a pandemic. The impacts. The first argument is that superbugs lead to extinction if they spread. The eighth point of this is that each new specific strain of superbug essentially requires a new treatment, which means that our science cannot keep up if we do not know all of the different types. Additionally, the next argument is that in particular, that means it's incredibly important to stop these superbugs at the source rather than treating them after they occur, which means that the proactive approach is the only way to resolve the issue of superbugs. Additionally, the argument is that one superbug can be enough to wipe out the entirety of humanity. We've seen plagues in the past have killed millions and millions of people, but now we have infrastructure that allows us to like fly places and drive in cars, which means transference between individuals increases as well, which means that the inevitability of extinction is there. The two argument is that this also hurts individuals on the periphery of class the most, or first. The eight point of this is that they are least likely to have access to clean water, as well as the fact that they have least access to clean water, as well as healthcare, which means at least politics disposability, because we allow these individuals to die first, which allows for other populations to then become disposable as well. The first argument is that UN water credibility is low in status quo. The eighth point is that the potential conflict cooperation mission created by the UN was unsuccessful, largely because of water scarcity in the regions that it operated, especially in the Middle East. So the UN has not been able to solve. The B argument is that they have been a reactive, not proactive approach to water scarcity. The C argument is that they essentially pick and choose who gets the water technology in the status quo. The example is Haiti. They literally, only a few weeks ago, they just got water for their disaster that happened over 5 years ago. The links. The first argument is the plan passed. The 8.1 is the UN is seen as a neutral actor. They don't pick and choose anymore because we say that all eligible countries are able to partake in the technology. The two arguments that being proactive, not reactive, is a good thing. The third argument is that we set a precedent for how engaging with developing countries takes place. We say a sense of credibility as well as neutrality is important. The example is that the UN wants to establish a water conflict solution, like a framework, but they haven't been able to because they don't have the credibility in the status quo. Internally, the first argument is that if there is no water arbiter, war is inevitable. Water is one of the most potent hotspots for conflict in the entirety of the world. Most conflicts in places like Africa, as well as the Middle East, happen because of water conflict to begin with. The next argument is that additionally, the impact, I guess, is we say water wars happen because it is the most likely hotspot for, war, I guess.
They don't have credibility, but like we can establish it, a greater reach is like the key internal one. So like the greater reach, just access to another country.
That's the key. That is well as the fact that they have the
That's so sad.
They have the distribution as well.
Sorry.
Several reasons. Welcome now.
Less viable, which means our allies necessarily always push back against working with the United States, but who said if the UN is
direction is zero, so which means that we would still literally, we would still literally start to fight back for these parts, but the next is US unilateralism is key, and we're with unilateralism inherently decreases this inherently leads to other countries wanting to counterbalance the future because they see an action, opportunity to act in the future, but next is the impact wanting to collapse the hegemony causes great power world, so we see other nations would always continue to fight for power when they know that the push back against the United States, which inherently would go nuclear because it's seen as one chance to actually defeat them too, is that hedge the impact of a filter in the world when the US hegemony decreases, and impact filters the rest of the world, to the rest of the impact means that water decimation becomes worse, and water wars become worse in a world where the US hegemony, US does not have an opportunity to step in, but also we say a transition would inevitably be worse, even if multipolar transition would inevitably fail it. There's not a world for a stable transition now in the status quo. This brings the entirety of the affirmative. Next, let's just solve it. That turns the water specifically, which means that people wouldn't be able to efficiently get access to water, which turns the entirety of water worse, because then this would be a worse war, and also the U.S. wouldn't be able to respond efficiently. First, that the UN delivery system is not seen as great right now. The U.N. has an impartiality doctrine. Essentially, they have to be impartial to each nation, which means that they can't align with any specific side, which also means they can't necessarily defend themselves because they can't take action against certain groups, which means that if there's any risk that someone attacks, like IE in Syria, where Assad literally attacks the water that's being drawn in, which means that there's not going to have solvency for any of the world, any of the nations that necessarily need it. We would specifically say that Syria is in high state of this now in this status quo, which means that you're not going to be able to resolve this anyways, but also we see the Taliban is able to resolve this because the U.S. has troops and they are able to send in their troops with the implementation of water aid, which is going to be able to resolve this, but also we say that the U.N. just gives aid to the parties, like they give to the parties to give to the people, which means the parties also take this and give it to like their military. That's same with Syria specifically. When you don't specify a certain nation, we say Syria would be the best nation, which means you're not able to resolve this. Only the U.S. can. On advantage one. Okay, first on the links. Okay, so first, you can respond to my argumentation about UN is not going to be able to implement this. You say this technology is so great and amazing, but again, the UN is not going to be able to implement this because they are always going to get attacked by the higher parties or the other nations there, which means that they're going to be able to build this up. The capitalists are going to be able to resolve this because the U.S. has the power to do so.
I have a minute.
Yeah. Okay. Also, on the impact, we say you are not going to be able to resolve anything, any of these superbug issues, because the question is whether or not we have access to vaccines, etc. But our next recommendation is that you ship bugging away from vaccines, and you just say that in massive problems about what necessarily what is the problem with, like, the problem is the fact that we don't have vaccines, we don't provide health care to these specific groups. That's probably what's on advantage to you. We've already given you reasons on why we turn this, but also we say the U.S. is going to be able to resolve the internal links in these scenarios, but also you can cross-play why they're not going to be able to resolve any of these, resolve any of the water wars, because the U.S. doesn't have the power or credibility to move into these nations. You've already seen right here, the credibility is low now. We say it's too far, too gone, and the U.S. is the only way to be able to resolve this in the future, which means that the affirmative is never going to be able to resolve this to where you're possible.
Thank you.
So let's do T on top, and then the counterplan, then the dis add, then the case in order. Any country that meets the definition of developing nations, again, any country that meets the definition of developing nations, roots for first can be ground, little A is going to be the next action to have greater ground on this because they can research why a country qualifies as a developing nation and then ensure they have a link. And then little B is going to be that this is also key because this is the next research burden. They have to determine which countries are developing. We don't have to give them a complete list. That'd be an incredible long list. The C is going to be that the list would specifically take away from PC time, which is going to underdevelop debates between two bad debate lag flash. Second is going to be this solves links. And A is going to be that we are the ones that create a key limit because if we create the list of what is and is not developing, that's going to allow for us to create an infinite number of potentially developing nations. Little B is going to be sticking with the definition of developing nations, create a one finite list of what is and is not developing, which is going to key to create a one limited a list of what could not be considered this round. The third argument is going to be there's no abuse. We literally gave them links. They have proven around abuse. Otherwise, there's going to be a reason to vote on the order of the voters. The first response is going to be debatability. If they had links in this round, which they clearly did, we did not no-link any of their stuff, and we're probably not going to use this as a reason to no-link that stuff. Means there's no round of abuse. You should shouldn't vote against this. Go to counterpoint. All right. The first argument here is going to be the permutation do both. They say that the perms can be inefficient, but it's not the idea. The U.S. and the U.N. work together all the time. Literally, the U.S. is one of the biggest actors in the U.N. The perm is going to be, the first step in perms can be double solvents. The delay is going to be that we literally double the amount of funding that's going to be over the case, which will lead to twice as much people having access to water. The second argument of this is going to be that that's going to be a net benefit over the link to the disadvantage, because the double solvency is going to lead to more people having access to water, which independently resolves for a systemic impact that kills literally 13,000 plus like people per day. Over time, that's going to be greater than any kind of thermonuclear war that could ever result from U.S. hegemony. That means that the double solvency independently overwhelms the impact of the linking back to the dis-ad. All right, and then the third argument is going to be the permutation also resolves the link to the dis-ad because when the U.S. and the U.N. work together, it looks like the U.S. has to lead the U.N. in the right way, which resolves U.S. hegemony, and it also makes the U.S. look integral to the power of the U.N. in the first place, which again creates that perceptual link. The fourth argument is it also helps to reverse Trump's isolationism. Trump's isolationism, I'll get to on the unit, this is causing the U.S. to lose hegemony. It's asking the only way to resolve that is to force the U.S. to engage more with the United Nations. So there's multiple reasons why the permutation not only resolves the link to the dis-ad, but independently has a net benefit that resolves the impact of the dis-ad, which means that the counterplan is just not going to be competitive. Let's go ahead and go on to the solvency. The first solvency deficit is going to be that there's no pre-existing program. The U.S. The United Nations has a program that we're going to be using to distribute this, but the U.S. doesn't have that program, which means that it would have to create supply chains in these nations, which means that there's no predictability for the solvency. Where's your predictability for the solvency of the app? The second is going to be that U.N. credibility advantage is not going to be solved, for U.N. credibility is key because it's already going to be seen as the water arbiter that resolves water disputes, but the U.S. is always selectively applying what disputes it just resolves. The U.S. is incredibly selective, and thus that nature, it ignores certain nations like Rwanda, for example, and allows for disputes to spin out of control, but the U.N. is not allowed to be so choosing. The third argument is going to be jurisdiction. The United States is not able to have the same jurisdiction as the United Nations because the United Nations is just better, like in terms of relationship with the global community. All right. Anything else that we need there? All right. Now I'm going to go into this side. All right. Go to the union. First on U.S. Hedge, terminally non-union.
Little A is going to be Donald Trump's engaging increasingly isolationist practice. For example, he's wanted to engage in a trade war with China, which is going to massively harm the U.S. economy, reduce our overall tax returns, and to decrease military spending. The second argument is he's reducing the funding of the EPA. The third argument is he's also pulling out the Paris Accords, which is massively harming the U.S. reputation with the global community because we agreed to that. Now we're pulling out the third. Or the fourth argument is he's going to also reverse the Iran deal, which is going to make the U.S. look weak because we seem to be unable to control Iran or able to make the deal we want. The fourth argument here is that Donald Trump literally just looks like an idiot. That's actually the argument. He just looks like an idiot. He's literally the laughingstock of the international community. The other guys are going to be massive. The fifth argument is going to be Rex Tillerson also has an incredibly controversial stance in the international community. He's very pro-Israel, and that pro-Israel stance is barely internationally disputed. The sixth argument is that we're also regressing on our movements on the Cuban embargo specifically because we are not moving towards removing the Cuban embargo instead, and then literally the UN hates the Cuban embargo because there's 152-2, the only two supporters of the Cuban embargo being the U.S. and Israel. The international community hates the direction that the U.S. is moving in right now, and that's just going to destroy U.S. hegemony terminally. Go ahead and go to the UN credibility. UN credibility can be low now, that's fine, that's the uniqueness for our advantage. Good, good, links. Okay, so this UN credibility terminal note, we say that no issues of UN credibility are compartmentalized, we only resolve for UN credibility within water scarcity. On the links. On the first link, they say that the strong UN constrains the USA. That's just empirically false. The USA is never constrained by the United Nations. It's not a zero-sum game. Usually their power is related because the US is such an integral part of the United Nations. On the second link, they talk about how UN success is going to decrease reliance on the USA, but that's probably not true. The point at which the USA engages in massive amounts of aid, that is just not going to be turned down. Just because the UN is giving people access to clean water doesn't mean that other US programs are going to be turned down. They talk about the World Bank pulling out. That's completely unrealistic. The World Bank stands to gain a lot of profit from the US. They would never pull out because something goes on. The fifth argument, talking about how unilateralism is key, we say, unilateralism is terminally non-unique. First off, it's going to be China's economy is massively exploding, and their GDP growth is way greater than US, which their economy is going to catch up. It's already one-third of its rising. Secondly, that Russia's economy is also growing, and their military expansionism is being increasingly successful. That means that there's two other powers quickly catching up to the US and unilateralism than ever. The fourth argument is that as long as the existence of the United Nations is there, unilateralism is already there. Going to the impacts. The first argument is great power wars. The United Nations actually resolves great power wars. The previous model of there having to be one hegemon is flawed at the point which the United Nations thought for systems of international cooperation to make peace a realistic probability. The second argument that hegemony is going to lead to a destruction of water filters is just false. U.S. colonialism specifically is what created the conditions of poverty in the nations that allowed for the water scarcity to exist in the first place. It was literally U.S. hegemony that led to those conditions by allowing for the neocolonialism that created U.S. corporations moving to those regions, creating massive amounts of systemic poverty. The only way to potentially resolve that is to reduce U.S. hegemony. Alright. On to the point. Extend all the background, extend all, and go on and solve. Alright, first thing says the UN delivery system is impartial, means that they can't defend the water, and then US troops will resolve this. The first argument is troop involvement is always terrible. Not only the US peacekeepers, but also US troops are notoriously terrible in developing regions because they engage in massive amounts of crimes in the region. They also like rape women and engage in all these other incredibly harmful, detrimental practices. Also, the US presence in most of the Middle East has been net worse for the region, stoking instability and justifying the existence of terror groups in the first place. We think that involving troops is always going to lead to a net worse outcome. They also talk about how parties are going to be the ones who get the water from the street. We say that's also going to be worse if you're talking about these regimes being the ones to distribute the water, and that doesn't make a lot of sense. That would probably be net worse. But the UN, you should rely on existing distribution routes that the UN has already set up instead of the US, which relies on putting boots on the ground and inevitably stoking more conflict in the region. Alright. On to advantage one. First, the uniqueness that right now superbugs are inevitably going to happen. It's only a question of whether or not we can protect individual developing nations. Going to the things they talk about how they cross the line, how the UN can't implement it because I answered that on the other flow, so you should deal with that now. Instead of this, spills over to other programs that ensure access to water scares. Water, go ahead and extend the internal link that right now superbugs are going to expand. Go to the impacts. They say that the question is vaccines. We say turn vaccines actually make it worse, and over reliance on vaccines breeds more superbugs. And the way to resolve this is questions of access to clean water. UV water filtration is the best because it doesn't use vaccines, and therefore it doesn't breed superbugs. This is going to be net better than status quo. Go ahead and go on to advantage two, on to the uniqueness. The person said the U.S. resolves the internal links. No, the U.S. is not going to resolve the internal links to water space because the U.N. has already established this. The U.S. engages in these nations very, very strategically to get what they want. They create conflict. We create proxy wars. The United Nations, on the other hand, doesn't have the same vested interests, and thus it makes it a much better arbiter for stopping water wars in the future.
In what ways do the United Nations' interests differ from that of the United States?
Yeah, so I think that you can just look at like, here, it's like U.S. involvement in the Middle East. very biased, very selective towards each other, right? U.S. involvement in Syria, very biased, very selective towards anti-Russia efforts. U.S. involvement in ASEAN, very biased, very subject towards reducing Chinese again. United Nations involvement is typically more international. At least there's an opportunity for developing nations to speak up. The fact is, when the U.S. involves, they push their agenda, which creates conflict. The U.N.'s involved, their only objective is peace.
So United Nations credibility is compartmentalized, that it's only increased their credibility in terms of allocating water?
Yeah, but the entire impact scenario is specifically about water, water wars. So that means even if they are compartmentalized, we only increase it to water, that's enough to resolve the pledge, too.
Why are
you sure? Yeah. Also, your tea was more of like a speck, to be fair.
Right.
Probably not.
This has the counterplan.
Oh.
And then the F one.
One more thought.
Paul Kelly.
Yeah.
This has the counterplan. The affirmative order.
Extend the meeting on top of the other word I pointed forth, nor to the disadvantage. A couple of concessions are going to be greatly entitled to speak. You can see that the pursuit of hegemony is an ethical issue. It's not a question of the trajectory of the United States to Germany rather than to plan as a bad question for where hegemony exists in the status quo in a world where the United States is always going to pursue hegemony. That means all the impacts are terminally, the negative impacts of Germany are terminally non-unique. That also means that the United Nations is always going to fail as a multipolar actor because the United States is inevitably going to be valued for hegemony. That just means it's declined. It's the good or bad for the United States to Germany in a world where you don't get a link to this problem. The fact that declines at least has a risk of being bad for the United States to Germany, which necessarily means you're going to be voting negative in the surroundings. Extinction is not good. You say Trump's isolationist in the status quo, but we see the status quo, the concept of the United States Navy and the United States Air Force. We see that it's utilized independently key to resolve the entirety of the union's take outs. You take it, you can see that the United States is able to actually ensure its security commitments in the status quo because it's based across the world, and also because it's able to massively sustain air superiority in any region, which means it's able to turn back confident in the status quo. The majority of your argument is probably taking effect in your responses, but also we see Trump's isolationist response. You say trade war is going to happen in the status quo, we say this is a response to our constraints argument, but we also say trade war is not going to happen in the status quo. Rather, this is Trump posturing against China, it's like, yeah, we want this, but it's never going to actually engage in a trade war. You say it's going to be kind of the EP, but we say this isn't going to pass the Senate, the status quo. We also ignore our words why the EP is keeping with Germany. You say the Paris Act said it can't be written, you're blind out, we've already agreed upon. We say there's no articulation, it's why soft power is being competed with Germany. Probably think the fact that you're not going to look to hard power. You say that he's going to reverse the Iran deal in the status quo. We say that as long as other countries believe that the United States can fulfill security to us, that's going to resolve the question of the Iran deal.
You say Trump's an idiot, you say Mattis isn't, so that probably resolves. We also say that, you know, the journalists of the Air Force and the Navy are probably key to check back the majority of the arguments. We also think Trump being an idiot is inevitable, but when you can see that Trump's always going to pursue the journey, it's just a question of whether or not, it's probably a question of positioning Trump in such a way that he can be as little of an idiot as possible. You can see that in a world where the United Nations doesn't gain credibility, this is going to be good.
You say Tillerson is really bad because he likes Israel. We say the commitment to Israel is probably a good thing, but we also say that Tillerson being bad is also not our response to the fact that the pursuit of hegemony is inevitable. You say that we are regressing on the embargo on the status quo, which is that the United Nations hates. We say this is not a war. So why hegemony is decreasing rather than why the United Nations relationships with the United States is increasing. There's no articulation of why the United Nations keeping the United States hegemony, which means dark videos all the also which to progress the United States foreign power is sufficient in the status quo, which means that even if you include the problem that has occurred in the status quo, the combination between our power and software is sufficient to resolve the entire thing. Take out your power response over again.
And yeah. That means we're ahead of the this question as much as we need to be. Again, I'm going to wax on this one last time, probably. In a world where the pursuit of hegemony is inevitable, it doesn't matter if we have or do not have hegemony. It matters if the plan collapses hegemony enough that we are to facilitate a transition. Place. Or no, the UN current arguments. You can see that the United Nations credibility is low as now. This means that the United Nations isn't able to check back Russia or China because the plan only increases their credibility in terms of water. There's no articulation about why water resolves great power wars, which means that you're not able to resolve the China and Russia scenario. That means that only the counterplan is at risk of resolving this argument. You say that issues are compartmentalized, we say this might be fine, but in a world where you increase credibility and the United States cooperation with the United States, we're still going to be winning a risk of a link. Go there now. First, we say that the plans and interests of the United Nations constraints. You said that A doesn't mean that the United States can be constrained, but we say this is a term we say in a little bit. The United Nations starts to take more action positively that necessarily increases the perception that other nations believe that the United States is going to be constrained by other ideas that the United Nations has taken. I mean, the World Rail Security Council vetoes something that the United States might agree, they're going to believe that the United States is going to be constrained to take that again. So this collapses the ability of other nations to believe in the United States and fulfilling their security commitments because they believe the United States is transitioning towards the United Nations. And the stance you've not answered these. See that in a world where the United Nations aid starts to increase its trade off of both the neoliberal institutions that are probably backed by the United Nations and the World Trade Organization, the argument is not that the World Trade Organization pulls off, but rather the United States is at the forefront of the World Trade Organization. The stance of the world where it believes to be, the United Nations is transitioning towards the dominant institution, and that's necessarily trades off the point where you can see that the United Nations is transitioning a multipolar organization. This necessarily means that it's going to be jailed to trade off the ability of the United States to act unilaterally, but you also say that it's going to be good.
Were you about the United States like looking like it's like leaving the United Nations?
Oh yeah.
You also can see the power projection is actually zero sum, which means in a world where the United Nations increases its power projection, it has to trade off with someone. We've isolated this trade off the ability for the United States to increase their power projection, which means that even if you're not buying the rest of our loop scenario, this is going to be sufficient trigger, whether it's going to be sufficient trigger, like when we have counterpart that results in the entire inferno, that is independently a piece of wiring, because obviously, because you can see how power actually works in a weird, how power works in a realistic fight, when states believe that other actors begin to gain legitimacy and begin to start taking more actions, that's trade. It's ultimately that certain actions have the ability to be the model of power in the world, essentially trades off. You can see it's already the problem is that the debate is all free. You also can see that you say that acting within the United Nations is you can see that the Security Council, this is probably a reason why you're not able to resolve the unilateralism of the link. The unilateralism of the only internal world of the United States continues to operate independently of that. It's probably part of you can see that this is unique to keep the United States having the dreams. At the point where you can see power projection, that's a reason why you're not able to resolve the argument. You try to say that Russia and China, you try to read Russia and China as like a parallel link term, maybe? I don't know. There's this Russia and China argument that I have on the links page. At the point where you're not able to increase the United Nations' credibility to resolve conflict, this is the reason why you're not able to resolve the Russia and China argument. But you've also seen enough of the impact level analysis that means the hedge is going to outweigh. So you're the impacts now. We see great powers, you see the United Nations is going to be able to resolve great powers, but this is an articulation of why this is necessarily true. We see the only way we're going to see our powers so high that we are able to deter the risk of conflict, we're going to be able to effectively check back great powers. There's no articulations of why the United Nations is going to be able to do this,
well,
Well, essentially, like, the last argument kind of just me. You put it on the counter, like, so. I'm just going to do some analysis, more so on my results. And then it's going to be the fact that I'm going to set.
Neoliberal institutions, they mishandle us. Don't let them do any work in our
vote will actually decrease hegemony. There are terms as to why this is true. They have conceded both the territory as well as the fact that the UN has a probability of increasing the chance of relations. And the United States actually looks great with whenever it's working with the UN, because it actually it looks like they're controlling the UN, which means it increases hegemony. Probably means there's only a risk of increasing hegemony. It won't be urban or the permutation, but there's zero risk of increasing hegemony. In fact, only a risk of decreasing, because of the weakness question on the dissent. Go to the top of case. The first argument I want to look at is that they completely conceded the argument about troop involvement and how it is bad. This is probably perceived probably pretty negatively amongst any country that the United States helps in, which means that ultimately it is a turn of hegemony worldwide. Additionally, the next argument is that, especially whenever they're isolating things like smart power is being keyed in hegemony on the weakness question of the dissent, it's probably really bad whenever we just use hard power. That's going to be an integral part of the speech. Additionally, the next argument is that U.S. involvement increases terrorism. That terrorism probably makes the U.S. feel bad again. That's all decreases hegemony. Additionally, the next argument is that we extend Skyler's argument about how essentially giving the stuff to parties leads to the regimes basically distributing the water in a bad way, which means that, again, it decreases the outlook on hegemony, which means that those are four independent turns to hegemony. And advantage one. Extend our entire scenario again. One they did not get to it with enough time in the MO. It's probably a killer argument, especially at the point that we are going outweigh on this extension level of superbox. They have made no time frame analysis to U.S. hegemony, but we say that superbox are already in the brick now, which means that we are waiting on a time frame question. Additionally, the next argument is that we are waiting on magnitude as well, because of the argument about the periphery. We say that this leads to politics disposability leading to unlimited violence, which means that we are outweighing on magnitude. Go to advantage two. Extend our advantage two scenario. They have not answered this as well. It means that the United States causes proxy wars. Those proxy wars probably look bad for hegemony, but also have their own external impact, which means they are always preferring the affirmative. Additionally, extend that leads to water wars without the action. That's bad. The first argument I want to look at is the argument about how, they try to make this argument about how the U.S. looks like it's being led by the U.N. They have conceded our argument about how the U.N. and the United States work together all the time, but the U.N. is perceived as a puppet of the United States, which means that it actually probably just increases hegemony and world permutation, which means the permutation is a really great idea. Additionally, the next argument is that it's the U.N. It's seen as the U.S. puppeteer in the U.N. Additionally, the next argument is that they say double funding, double solvency argument just isn't true. But that's not responsive. We say that the imaginary world of permutation, right, that we can use to test the competition of these two, it probably just has a net benefit. That is a net benefit to a counterplan. It's probably a reason why we get double solvency. It's a really great thing. It means the counterplan probably just goes away, which means they have no solvency for this end. Additionally, the next argument is that
they conceded no jurisdiction for the U.S.
Oh, they have conceded our no jurisdiction for the U.S. argumentation. There are places that the U.S. can't just go to provide this water technology, which means the solvency of the counterplan and the affirmative together is able to resolve this. Additionally, in particular, we isolate the example of Rwanda, which means that, that's how the U.S. is selected. But there are instances where the United States cannot go in, which means that nonprofits and stuff is not enough to overwhelm this. They can't get into some places, which means the UN is a fundamentally better actor that resolves all the same kind of question of the UN not being able to go into certain places. Extend the permutation to both the US and the UN should work together. One thing at the very bottom of this. They make the argument about UN credibility, on UN credibility. Extend Skyler's argument about the U.S., how they're selective, specifically about Rwanda. That means it actually looks worse for those countries, which decreases hegemony because they isolate smart powers being important to decide unique exposure to the decide. They make a lot of argumentations why the United States will always struggle for hegemony. Sure, that's fine. It doesn't matter, because at the end of the day, if there's a net decrease in hegemony in a world of the counterplan, it only leads to that same scenario. It doesn't matter. It's a fundamental misconception on their uniqueness level. Additionally, the next argument is that in a world where Trump already looks bad, it makes the United States acting look worse, which means that only the UN is able to resolve this because they can hide all of the problems by essentially puppeteering the UN. Additionally, the next argument is that, what do you want to extend? They make the argument on the Cuban embargo argument that why is that key to U.S. hegemony? Well, the U.N. contains hundreds of countries all across the world, which means that the international community's perception of the United States, which literally creates hegemony, that's the internal link to it. Additionally, the next argument is that
they also mishandle China and Russia inevitably leads to multinational states there as well.
Additionally, drop down to the internal link. The argument here that they have completely mishandled is that China and Russia are already going to outpace the United States, which means all of their impacts are inevitable. So even if we're losing all the hegemony turns in the entirety of this debate, it does not matter, because all their impacts are fundamentally inevitable. It means the permutation is able to resolve everything, but also the app is just a good idea, because we outweigh on the extinction level superbugs that are inevitable and completely leaked from the scenario.